conference entitled Mobilising African Intellectuals Towards Quality Tertiary Education took place in Kigali in July. It was hosted by the Sustainable Development Goals Centre for Africa, and the objective was to create a coalition of African intellectuals to address themes relevant to SDG implementation in tertiary education and research. CNBC Africa's Bonney, Tunya moderates this discussion on the quality of tertiary education in Africa.
So, ladies and gentlemen, for the next few moments, I'd like us to consider the question of the quality of tertiary education, because we've talked about the fact that there is already something that is happening, but are we happy with the quality? And if indeed, what then should be our yardstick for measuring the quality of this very education we talk about? In a sense of opening remarks, I'd like to first introduce, in no particular order, Dr. Price from the University of Cape Town. Just give us a sense of what you make of this question of the quality of the of tertiary education on the continent and basing it on your experience.
Well, in several of the introductory speeches in the previous session, one could assume that quality was being measured by how universities perform in the rankings. And therefore, they were being telling us over and over, quality is poor. On the continent as a whole, some 10 universities from Africa in the top 1,000, and about half of them are in South Africa and half of them in Egypt. So I don't think we need to spend a lot of time worrying or debating the quality is poor. I do want to say something, though, about why I think the rankings is a particularly iniquitous an inappropriate way to measure quality, and why I would not align myself with the call to have 25 or 30 universities in the top 200 or 300, because it gives a credit and a legitimacy to that ranking system, which I think is really problematic. So you might be surprised that that is coming from me, from the University of Cape Town, which is ranked number one in the continent and has been on most of the ranking systems. But in a sense, that's what gives me the permission to say this, whereas anyone else saying this would be accused of sour grapes because they were not at number one. Well, what is it about the rankings and why am I so critical? There's lots of critiques and they have to do with the indicators used and how they're judged. But the most important thing is that it is an ordinal ranking. In other words, for you to go up, someone else has to go down. And it doesn't seem to me that that is an appropriate way to measure our quality. And to give you an example from UCT, University of Cape Town, for several years now, we have gone up on every one of the indicators. One indicator is the number of publications. Another indicator is the number of citations. Another indicator is your staff-student ratio. Another indicator is your reputation amongst peers. We go up on the score on every one of them, but we go down in the rankings. So you can improve your quality all the time, but not get up in the rankings because the people above you are getting up a bit faster, or the people just shortly behind you are going up faster. And it's all about money. I'm going to come back to the issue of money, how much one spends on it, and how one works the system. So I would propose that one of the initiatives that we collectively as intellectuals, academics on the continent, and more widely should do is to shift to a different system of quality assessment, something more like a hotel star rating system. As hotels are rated from 1 star to 5 star, there's no limit on how many 5 star hotels there can be, but the objective, the criteria are objective, and it's relatively easy to assess whether you make that criteria or not. There's no reason then why we shouldn't have 30 or 40 African universities that are 5 star universities. But I think we set ourselves up to fail if our goal is to have 30 in the top 300. That's my view. Now let's come to how we get there. And as I said, I think it's largely about funding and it's about policy. And I have 6 points to make about funding briefly. The first is that an idea we were asked to respond to the concept paper. One of the ideas in the concept paper which the Sustainability Network has proposed is that there should be a global fund for education. An elaboration of that would be a global fund for African education. And this would be a fund which I think should support all universities, not just the universities aspiring to get into the top 30. And I think that there is a strong moral case that we have failed to make and we should be making at this conference and in the future, which relates very much to that issue of brain drain, which the previous speakers have commented on. If you grow cocoa, a natural resource, and you process it, and you export it, you expect to be paid for it as the country of origin. But when you grow into the academics, people, you have the natural resource, which is the people, you invest in 12 years of K through 12 education, you invest in another 6 or maybe 10 years of higher education, and then they leave. A massive investment, and in Africa, most of that investment has been public investment by the state, and yet the country gets nothing from that investment. You give it away. We give it away. Now, it's not a simple thing to address that. I don't think you can stop the brain drain, nor should we, by controlling passports or controlling travel. I think it's also very difficult to do it by forcing people to pay back the money themselves that they have benefited. But I do think we could have an international funding system that can monitor and calculate how many graduates from Ghana are currently working in Canada, roughly what the cost of that education was, and therefore expect Canada to pay Ghana or to pay into a global fund to fund that. And it comes out on swings and roundabouts. So I would like to strongly propose that a global fund be, we need to get, this needs to be an idea we popularize, needs an idea we defend morally, not only because a global fund would help us address this critical need of higher education in the continent, but because it's morally a reparation that we are entitled to. The second area, which it relates to getting our own governments to subscribe to the commitment or to fill the commitment they've made in the past. I think it was in 2005 when they said that they would spend 1% of GDP on higher education. Unfortunately, the interpretation of that commitment is a little fuzzy because it's 1% of GDP. Some countries have high tax level, tax proportions of GDP, and some have low proportions of GDP. But actually, the commitment is for a government spend. Sometimes you have big private sectors, and sometimes that's included in the calculation. So I think we should refine our understanding of that commitment. We should renew that commitment by governments. It should probably be a percent of tax revenue rather than a percent of GDP. It should probably refer to what government spends rather than what the total spend is. But that we should work on that to say, and then governments can be held to account if they're willing to sign that. Thirdly, I think we should take a hard look, and this is the hardest thing for me to say here because it's going to be unpopular and I won't have time to qualify it. But if you want to get some universities into what I'm calling the five-star category, if you want to get 30 universities, you need to recognize, we collectively need to recognize, that those universities will cost two or three times what a standard, what a typical university costs to run. You need a much higher staff-student ratio so that staff can be spending 50% of their time on research. In our current environment, after the massification of higher education, category, and that can't be done by spreading the money everywhere.
On the ranking issue, they are based on the need they meet in the jurisdictions in which they operate, and how does that compare with African universities?
I'm saying it's a different context. You know, the challenges that we have to address in Africa are very different from the challenges that Harvard University had to address when it was established 300 years ago. You know, many of these, and this relates to my second point, a lot of the rankings and quality today is based on inputs. So we look at inputs like, you know, what professor, how many PhDs do you have on staff? You know, how many computers do you have? How much land do you have? How many credit hours do you spend? But yet we're talking about a challenge that this continent faces. We're running out of time. In 18 years, we'll need to have 1.1 billion jobs that this continent needs. The U.S. didn't have that challenge when they were setting up their universities. So, you know, we need a different vehicle to get there. And I think we should rather be looking at outputs to track quality. Let's look at outputs. So track the quality of a university by what percentage of its graduates are getting jobs? You know, what percentage of them are becoming entrepreneurs? And how many jobs are those entrepreneurs creating? What sort of patents and innovation are coming out of the university? What skills are the graduates coming out with? How are they applying those skills to solve African problems? Those things are not on the rankings list. So if we go that way, we are going to build universities that are no longer relevant for the context that we're in.
Right. Let me just bring in Minister Malimba. Thank you. Thank you for your submission. And it seems like we can't run away from the ranking issue because Minister Malimba, the Africa Capacity Report of the SCBF ranks Rwanda as third in science, technology, and innovation capacity. Speak to us in regards to that, looking at, if you look at history, Rwanda is a fairly young country. How were you able to do this in answering the question of quality?
Thank you very much. I think this goes to, it starts with the policy level and the significant amount of investment the government of Rwanda has been investing in harnessing the value of partnership. If we start from the question of the traffic of students leaving African continent, going to USC, to Europe, or elsewhere, we need to start by looking at those factors which actually necessitate this one direction flow of students. Now, as a solution maybe to curtail that flow of students from Rwanda and the other parts of Africa going to overseas, we needed to bring those institutions here in Rwanda so that instead of seeking, you know, that qualification which is attainable in those universities, the government of Rwanda has created a strong partnership to attract this institution to come here. And the living example is the Carnegie Mellon University, is the African Institute of Mathematical Sciences, is African Leadership University, and a couple of other centers of excellence which has been set up here. So looking at from the policy issue and the prospect which comes with these institutions, either from the region or from the global, coming to set the shop here, and the potential of amount of innovation and creativity which are coming from these centers, I think that's one of the factors which has been contributing, at least Rwanda, to rise, to be ranked highly, because there is that high level of political will and commitment and significant investment, which of course, both in short term and long term, is going to add significantly into the creation of the 21st century knowledge in science, technology, innovation, and creativity.
Right, and thanks for making it very clear that there has to be some intentionality from policymakers in terms of these homegrown solutions don't just happen, right? There's some policy that needs to go into that. Well, but we're talking about policy. Let me just bring in Mr. Kato on the issue of those collaborations and that sort of synergy. He's talked about policy, he's talked about homegrown solutions and designing institutions that meet the African need. But I think it's important also to work with people who've already been through that road. Talk to us a little bit about the partnership, and especially in the ASEAN networks.
Thank you very much. And before answering that question, I'd like to take a puff of a little bit of time to explain why I'm here, because many of you might be wondering why a representative of Japanese agency is sitting here. To make a long story short, we learned of the idea of establishing a Sustainable Development Goals Center in Kigali some 1.5 years ago. And we thought it would be a very worthwhile endeavor, and became interested and have been working together with Dr. Belai and other leaders of the center to what will, the two organizations can do together to achieve this laudable goals. And another reason is that the tertiary education improvement is one of the agendas that the Japanese government is putting an emphasis on. That's why I'm here. So I'm sorry for this short introductory remarks. And to get back to the question, well, I'm not sure if I got your question completely right, but let me tell you how I see the issue of quality of tertiary education. And there are a number of ways to interpret or define the quality of education in university. But I think the biggest testimony of good quality education in university is how the graduates can find jobs, the employability of the graduates. And the issues that we have had in Tunisia, the Arab Spring, is a testimony that the perhaps there is a mismatch between what is demanded by the private sector and what is supplied by the universities. So one hypothetical way of giving an answer to this complex question, somewhat simplified answer, would be to make university education more practical oriented, problem solving oriented one, rather than theoretical or academic ones. Well, I'm making a very simplified discussion, but maybe making the educational system more engineered, geared toward the needs of the private sector and the community of African countries is the key. And how can we do that? Well, there is no panacea for this challenging task, but we have some experiences working together with some African counterparts, like the Jomo Kenyatta University of Agriculture and Technology, the Vice Chancellor of which is going to talk about this afternoon later. We have done a couple of efforts to change the way that a university education is provided. And thanks to the efforts of the university, the employment rate of the graduates is very successful. So if with appropriate effort of the universities, we can surely improve the quality of university education defined in terms of the employability of their graduates. I have other issues, but let me stop here because of the time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And gentlemen, it seems like we're all agreeing to the fact, to certain things here. And I think quality has a big correlation with the funding and the resources thereof. And I'd like to bring Professor Sachs in this. Please speak to funding, either from a status update point of view to where we need to go, but also I'd like to hear your final word on this ranking conversation.
Thank you very much. Let me start by saying that the number of rankings and the bases of these rankings are evolving rapidly, so I wouldn't get too hung up about the specifics, because by 2030, all of this is going to look very different. But what I would like to see is Africa high on global lists. These lists are going to be on different criteria, because there already is a lot of evolution. But I believe that the standards should be global standards, and we're going to see very interesting new measurements for the reasons that were discussed. The whole nature of higher education is evolving, and in some very important and exciting ways. So one very basic point on financing. Information technology allows education at a much lower cost. If your university is not with wonderful broadband, it will have no chance to compete. So you better be connected with high bandwidth and with the capacity to participate in global information flows at a very high quality. And if the Ministry of Education is saying we don't have the money for that, we don't have the time for that, then they don't have the time for your university. Because universities depend now on their bandwidth. If you have it, it's a fixed cost that makes possible low cost delivery of quality in multiple ways. Let me give one example that I'm not an expert on, except as a user. It may be farther along than I know, but if it's not, I'm going to help to solve this problem. When I get online in the morning at Columbia University, I access for free immediately 50,000 journals. The marginal cost of bringing Africa's universities to 50,000 journals is almost zero. So we should make sure that at a policy level, that African universities have access either for free or at very low cost to what universities in the United States spend quite a bit of money on. But that's all right for this purpose. We need to make sure that there's an access for what is a zero marginal cost commodity right now, which is thousands and thousands of quality journals, so that this is not a barrier. This is something that technology allows. You don't have to build a library of 2 million volumes. They're online. And they're online basically at almost no marginal cost. You may be charged for them right now, exorbitant amounts, but that's a policy issue that we can break down, not an intrinsic economic factor. I would emphasize information technology is playing a huge role for leapfrogging and raising the quality. Courses online, distance education, research partnering, free library access, classrooms that are extended, one excellent professor teaching to 50 different universities on a screen, no problem. Virtual conferences, speeches, seminars that are globalized. This was not possible 5 years ago. This is where the leapfrogging can come in. We have to really be creative in opening up how the teaching is done, how the information is done, how the seminars are organized, who's a professor at what school, because now you can be virtually teaching anywhere.
Right.
That's really important. So I think the rankings, I want to put it aside a little bit. It's going to take care of itself because rankings that are old-fashioned and backward-looking, no one's going to look at anyway. The rankings themselves are going to change. But what is true is that excellence of education is a real thing. That's not a mirage. That's a real thing.
Right.
And so that we need to work on. And I think we, if we're creative, we can find all sorts of ways to open the channels for partnerships, for faculty exchanges, for broader curricula, for really leapfrogging. And I don't think this would have been possible 10 years ago, but I think it's possible now.
Right. And thanks, Professor, for very clear, tangible, practical ways of cutting the whole cost issue. One is adoption of tech. Gentlemen, I'd like to stick a little bit to...
I should add one more thing, if I could. I want to help you raise money, too. I'm not saying it's all free. I didn't mean to imply. I just mean that there are low-cost ways to do what used to come at very high cost.
Right.
So we should go both directions.
Right.
Lowering the cost and raising the funds.
Correct. So let's dwell a little bit on that funding issue, because for a lot of the universities on the continent, it is a big problem. Let me just bring in Dr. Hamdok on this issue, and just skipping to what the prof has said, very practical ways in which African institutions can improve and work on this funding issue.
Thank you very much. I think before getting to this issue of funding, I wanted to link this debate on leapfrogging and also the policy making and research and linking to the issue of SDGs, eradicating poverty, and how linking research, policy making to this issue. I would like to believe the main issue here is to develop capabilities, upgrading and all that, in the sense that will help us to sustain the economic growth that is needed to address poverty. You know, to eradicate poverty, you need to grow the economy for several decades at very high rate. This is extremely difficult. Very few countries were able to do it. But they have done it through building capabilities and upgrading their universities. If you take, I would just want to select this by a simple example of South Korea, a country which was very similar to our economies some 40, 50 years ago. If you look at their funding of building capabilities exemplified in the R&D, in 1980, South Korea R&D as percentage of GDP was 0.7%. 85, it rose to 1.5%. By 2000, it went up to 2%. Today, it's around 4%. This shows clearly where the commitment is. South Korea is a very poor country in terms of natural resources and all that, but they made it. I mean, you know the history that they were having per capita GDP less than Ghana in 1960. You can see where they are. In the tertiary education enrollment, Around 1980, it was about 10%. 85, it went to 30%. By 2000, it was 70%. R&D from the private sector was about 70%. These are things within our reach. I think that many of our countries are moving in these directions. I commend Rwanda in 95. It was the growth rate between 95 and 2014. I think it was probably 3 or 4 digits change in terms of resources put into R&D. So I think this is an issue. But going back to your question about funding education, we need to be innovative here. Government has to take the prime, as His Excellency the President said, responsibility for this, but it has to be in partnership with others. There are so many ways of looking at innovative sources of funding our education. If you go to 1960s, when the first National University of Botswana was established, actually the seed money that established that university came from cattle donated by the chiefs in the country. The president went around and collecting this. This is one very small part of this thing. But I think the prime issue is to accord education and research and development and innovation the prime sort of priority when allocating resources. If we would like to develop, I think this is a way we need to move. Thank you.
Right, and let me just bring in Dr. Swanik on this.
Let me rather talk on this cost issue, because that's one place where I think I'd like to offer an innovative solution to the cost issue. For me, the finance of higher education has to address there's two angles. One is how do you reduce the cost, and the second is are there innovative forms of student finance? So, for example, we set out on a mission to develop 3 million leaders for Africa by 2060. And to do this, we realized we needed a very, very innovative model that would much lower cost. But also maintain the quality. So for example, today to go to a Western, if you go to Princeton University, for example, the degree is a 4-year degree, and you pay $60,000 a year. So you spend $240,000 for a degree there. When we analyzed, though, the academic calendar of Princeton, we saw that their students are on vacation for between 5 to 6 months of the year. So you're paying $240,000 for 2.3 years of education. So in our model, we said, let's cut out the holiday. And rather, the students spend 8 months on campus and 4 months in a job every year. So by the time they graduate, they already have year work experience, and you reduce the time they're there, so therefore you reduce the cost. We also completely re-engineered the way we use our real estate. And because of combination of online learning and peer learning and so forth, and we need much fewer classrooms. And as a result, Princeton, for example, has 900,000 square meters of space for 8,000 students. When we get to scale, we'll only need $80,000 square meters of space, 1/10 the space as Princeton, by re-engineering, rethinking things. Yet, our students are being hired by the same companies that Princeton is hiring. So our students are being hired by Bain & Company, by McKinsey, by IBM, all these companies, and the employers are so impressed that they're now coming to us and asking us to train their staff. So this is what I mean by thinking about a different model and attaining high quality, but even at significantly lower cost. Now, in the financing of these students, traditionally, when higher education has been made accessible, there have been four methods. One is from government. The second is from families themselves. The third, maybe philanthropy. And then the fourth is from banks, private financial institutions. In Africa, we looked at and we figured those four will not allow us to meet our goals. Governments are cash-strapped. Families can't afford to pay fees, most families. Private sector institutions, banks are charging 30 to 40% interest rates. And philanthropy is limited in terms of the scale it can reach. So we've created something called an income sharing arrangement, where we set up a finance company. It's called African Leadership Finance Corporation, that actually attracts capital from investors. And then that capital finances the student's education. And then when the student graduates, it's not a loan that they have to pay with interest, but rather they share a percentage of their income back with the finance company. So they share 10% of their income for 10 years, and then they're done. So if they're unemployed, they don't have to pay anything. If you're working in a low-paying job, you're paying just a percentage. If you're working in a high-paying job, you're also paying a percentage. So what we're saying is that African students don't have the financing for their education today, but they will when they get a job. And so let them pay for their education after the fact. And Australia has done this on the national level, and today it finances about 30% of their higher education budget. So this would, I believe, is a way in which higher education can be made very accessible by giving returns to investors, universities get their revenue, and student gets a free or reduced cost education. And these are the kinds of innovative things we need to think about because, as I mentioned, the West didn't develop systems like this. They have student loan systems, and that's become highly unsustainable. And we need different ways of doing things if we're going to solve this problem.
Right. And let me just bring in Dr. Price still on this. You mentioned in your earlier submission that we need to set priority areas as far as funding. There's no point of funding everybody at a mediocre level. Speak to us on specifics of how, with the limited resources coming from the budgetary allocations, what are some of the specific areas of priority that governments or institutions or indeed ministries can put their money in?
I was differentiating between funding the educational project more generally, which I think should be widespread, and something like an education fund could be used for that. And I agree with the idea of a what's often called a contingent loan system, a system where students borrow money, or they pay their fees, and they pay afterwards based on what they're earning. And actually, Britain has that system. It's reasonably widespread, and South Africa happens to have that system as well. But just as a lesson for others, it has to be adequately capitalized. If you have the whole nation's students needing that funding and half of them can't get it, or they can only get half the funding and it runs out, then you have a bigger crisis. But I do think it's the right way to go. The research funding was the area where, which is what's required for the universities to bring a 30 or whatever into a world-class competitive basis. And there I think you have to assess, I think you need to create critical masses at each university. Today research and research programs are not unidisciplinary. So to fund only agriculture at one place and say that's the Center for Excellence for Agriculture and that's the Center for Excellence for Marine Sciences and that's for IT, I think misses the trends of development in research, which is actually that things are much more interdisciplinary today. If you're going to be studying SDG, urbanization and urban sustainability, you're going to need social scientists, you're going to need civil engineers, you're going to need people who look at water and renewable energy, people who manage traffic, people who think about law and the environment. And so you actually want a university which is good at all of those areas. You need the critical mass across the area. So my view would be that you start off by prioritizing some institutions rather than prioritizing a particular discipline. You select those institutions that are most likely in the next 20 to 30 years because of their current, and it's going to be history, for better or worse, and they've got significant numbers of researchers, they've got a research ethic, they've got significant numbers of people with PhDs, they've got decent facilities already. That's where I think one should invest in, but not exclusively, and I make this point, that it's not to create a massive divide between those and the rest. I would say that we should have on the continent a research fund, a bit like the European Union Horizon 2020 fund, where the countries and other funders and donors have put money into research, and then there's a competitive bidding process. And the requirement of the bid is that perhaps it should address an SDG or more, that there should be at least three universities that are selected from the from this top 30 that are partners in that research program, and that there should be a number of other universities or centers of excellence which are outside of those core universities that are included in as well, so that the investment is spreading to the continent more widely. But it will need some concentration if we're going to raise those institutions.
Yeah. Right. And gentlemen, I'd like us to shift gears slightly from the funding issue to sort of set some points of action as we go forward, right? Have we equipped our young people well enough? The challenges notwithstanding, have we equipped them well enough to reap the demographic dividend? And what can we do now in the circumstances that we find ourselves?
In my point of view, there are three fundamental issues which we need to address.
The first one has been talked about, actually, even through the keynote remarks, and even one of the panelists here. It is teacher and faculty development, both pre-service development, but also in-service development through professional continuous development strategy. But also we need to figure out how do we attract young brain, young talents to fall in love with the teaching profession, either at basic education or at the tertiary education. Number two, I think we need to harness the power of digital education, because we are seeing that with the current development of information technology, actually knowledge and information is fungible. It is available everywhere. And most of the time at free of cost or at a very cheap way. But the only difference which makes this information work elsewhere and not in Africa, it is the mode of delivery. Today, our teaching method, teaching and learning method, is heavily overloaded through lecture system. But the lecturing system is the thing of the past. I think we need to focus on how we can enhance teaching and learning, either creating a problem for students to solve, or creating a project for students to work on, or by creating a product for the student to develop this product. And through either be it problem-based learning, the project-based learning, or the product-based learning, these students, they can learn amount of information and cross-discipline-wise. The third area, we need to strike a very good balance between developing of science, technology, engineering, mathematics, but also and social science, because there is a lot of interrelationship and intermarriage between these two disciplines. But also, I think, in African continent, we've been emphasizing a lot in churning out the white-collar job, and we are lacking a critical mass of the people who have hands-on skills. Right. So development of the technical and vocation and training education is very key, because today if you need one doctor, maybe you need 70 other assistants to the doctors, either nurses or laboratory technician. If you need one engineer, then you need 70 technical, middle level technicians who need to assist this engineer in order to work. If I take the case of Rwanda, for example, we have the policy of making sure that at least 60% of the students graduating from lower secondary education, they should follow the track of the technical and vocational training, and only 40% goes to the general education. That is in line of how many people do you need at the top and how many middle-level technicians you need to assist these people on the top notch. And to that effect, actually, we have crafted a curricula, the cross curricula, which provides the pathways between the general education and the technical education. Because in the past, the people who followed the technical education, they seem to be the people who were academic failures or who would hit a deadlock, because there is no such flexibility and pathways at any point of time to switch from one discipline to another. So I think these are key three areas which you need to address.
Minister, allow me to push back a little bit. How then do you encourage the idea you've proposed, like the 40-60 rule? Because like in my home country, Kenya, a lot of the technical institutions have now been converted to be constituent colleges of universities, and a lot of young people would want a degree in anthropology other than engineering, for example. This is a system that it is the opportunities that are there that are pushing them there. It's not that they do not want. How do you encourage them to go that route?
In the current situation where the formal employment is dwindling, and actually we are encouraging people to acquire knowledge and skills so that they can translate these skills and knowledge into creating jobs for themselves and for others, I think we need to find the convergence between the general curricula and the TVET curricula. And this convergence can be provided only when we are not only focusing on the technical and hard skills per se, but we need also to focus on the soft areas. For example, entrepreneurship nowadays shouldn't be seen as a stand-alone subject. Rather, entrepreneurship and innovation, it should be embedded across horizontally and vertically in all other curricula which you are teaching. And in so doing, I can see that we should be able to provide the convergence between the general education and the technical education. That's one. But also we need to provide opportunity, more opportunity, by building more institutions, you know, not only at the tertiary level, but also the second level,
right,
vocational technical training institutions, instead of rolling out general secondary schools.
Right, Mr. Kato, still on the same issue of how prepared are our young people for the future?
I think it depends on the development strategy of the country. If a certain country thinks that they can develop their country by developing large-scale industries, labor-intensive industries, and building a huge number of factories, and inviting lots of foreign investors who will recruit local people, then maybe they can arrange university education in such a way that young people will be well prepared to work for big factories and big companies. But I doubt if it is possible in many of African countries, because unfortunately infrastructure is still very lacking, and many other conditions that will induce large firms in foreign countries to invest in Africa. Therefore, I think many African countries must tap into the entrepreneurship potentials of the young people. Instead of telling them and preparing them to work for large companies, maybe we have to prepare them to be an entrepreneur and to be creatively self-employed. And in order for that, maybe we need to have a different type of tertiary education, stressing the importance of innovation and proactive problem solving. And again, that's what we have been doing with Jomo Kenyatta University, trying to encourage the creative and entrepreneur-like behaviors of the young people. And also in Rwanda too, I think the Rwandan government has been doing a lot of work to encourage the young people who are very much familiar with ICT skills and knowledge, and what they lack is a small amount of seed money. So therefore, maybe the Rwandan government trying to do is to encourage the young people to come together and learn from each other and provide some seed money and grow it to young entrepreneurs. And that's the type of high tertiary education many of the countries, African countries, need for the moment.
All right, let's have Professor Sachs before I come to Dr. Price. Still on the same issue, we're talking about this preparedness, and we've outlined the situation in which we find ourselves, but we cannot sit and wait. What do we need to deconstruct?
Well, I think one thing should be obvious, and it hasn't been mentioned. We're talking about improving university education, which is what brings us here, and it's crucial. But the situation in primary and secondary education in Africa is dire. And so these are not to be competing agendas. They're part of the same agenda. The completion rate of secondary school in sub-Saharan Africa remains less than 25%. That's an impossibility for development. So this is absolutely why SDG 4 was agreed, which is universal secondary completion by 2030. That by itself is a research problem also. I would like universities to ask themselves the question, how can our country achieve universal secondary education within under 15 years? It can't be done the normal way. It's not the normal cycle. It has to be done through a number of innovations, again, with information technology and linked classrooms and different ways to scale beyond what we have done before. But the goal here is not simply outstanding elite institutions, which are crucial, but also mass education, especially through the secondary level. And there are many, many indicators that this is not happening properly right now. And I'd like to mention a point of terminology, because I think that there's also a big issue here. It's highly controversial. Many people are sensitive to it, but I think it's important to state. What does the demographic dividend mean? It does not mean a lot of young people. The demographic dividend means a lot of young people followed by much fewer younger people. The demographic dividend is only achieved through a reduction of fertility. It does not mean every generation has young people, bigger and bigger. Africa's current trajectory is a fertility rate of 5, which is the average across the continent, by far the highest in the world, and a demographic medium forecast of reaching 4 billion people in 2100. That's not a demographic dividend. You could say, well, Africa will have most of the young people in the world. That's true. And it will have the highest young dependency rate in the world by far, which is not a dividend, it's a burden. So how did China leapfrog in education? By a dramatic decline of the total fertility rate, so that the investment per child was multiplied tremendously. In a poor family with 5 children, where one gets an education and the other do not, that's not a dividend. And so I think that it's really important, again, this is taking us a little bit beyond our topic, but the basic idea of for Africa's breakthrough, in my view, includes universal secondary completion now. That every country is saying, if you're in school, we're going to help you stay in school till at least the end of high school, girls and boys, not dropping out in sixth grade or seventh grade. Especially for girls, but everybody continues through. That by itself will be the number one factor in reducing fertility rates by far.
Right.
Then many of those, and we should think about that, but I would say aiming for at least 20 or 25% in some way, and it will evolve institutionally what it means, becoming part of tertiary education. 3 or 4 times the rate of now. But those need to be quantified, all of those parameters. But don't think that the situation is even close to adequate right now, because both on the measured quality of the outputs at age 13 and 15, Africa is ranking very low, and the proportion of kids staying in school at those levels is dreadfully low. Now, I'm the first to say this can be turned around faster than ever seen in history before. That's my very strong belief, and not just out of wishful thinking or being nice, but very practical means. Now, let's make the change. But the current situation, not even close to adequate.
Dr. Price.
I'm picking up your question on, are we producing the right graduates and are they the right match for what society needs? And that question arises because we often hear talk about unemployed graduates and the risk that we just have more graduates but don't actually address the economic needs of society. And my caution is to, or I want to caution that although we're talking as a continent, there is a lot of heterogeneity, and even within a country, we need to understand the causes of graduate unemployment before we jump to fixing it. And I think the causes are different in different places. Within South Africa, the cause may have a lot to do with the quality rather than the curricula and the subjects and whether there has been partnerships with industry and et cetera. Or it may have to do with the schooling, or the fact that universities, because of a sort of ranking that happens almost automatically, some universities attract students from one set of schools that have had a much 12 years of very good schooling, and other universities are attracting kids who have a weaker schooling, and the product may be, they may not have, the, if it's a standard curriculum, a three-year degree or a four-year degree, that may not be suited to the different inputs. So we need to understand whether it is quality. It may be that the curricula are not appropriate, and I think that's going to be the case, but that requires a different solution. It may be that employers are expecting graduates to be work-ready, and that requires a discussion between us, because most of our curricula, from the university's point of view, are not designed to make people work-ready at the time of graduation. We expect a car manufacturer to take one of our engineers and have to still train them for 2 years before they can really function independently, because the nature of our engineering degree is to produce engineers for 100 different engineering industries, and you couldn't specialize them in all of that, and that would be inappropriate. So we do a sort of generic stem cell engineer, if you like, who can then differentiate. So there may be a mismatch of expectations as well. I think we also need to do more research on the extent to which the non-STEM graduates are getting jobs, because there's a risk that with all the emphasis on more STEM, that there's an undertone, there's an implication that those who are doing humanities, social sciences, law, are not as needed in the economy and not as successful in the economy. And while that may be true in some cases, I think that actually reflects quality more than curriculum content. We recognize that our graduates will probably have four or five jobs in their lives, and that when they, but they'll only be at university full-time once, and that this university experience is an opportunity to prepare them for all of those four jobs with a whole range of generic skills rather than the first job that they're going to get after graduating. So that discussion, I think, needs to be unpacked in more detail.
Right. Thank you for that, Dr. Price. And I'd like just to give a minute each to my other four panelists to give your closing comments. At the very end, Mr. Toka, coming down.
I'd like to talk a bit about partnership. Despite the less than optimal situation of tertiary education in Africa, I think the opportunities are huge, because many countries outside Africa, governments, universities and international cooperation organizations believe in the bright future of Africa, and the investment in tertiary education in Africa is worthwhile. Many organizations believe that way. So in that sense, maybe universities in Africa have faced with huge opportunities and partnerships, and hundreds and thousands of organizations are offering research grants, scholarships, and so opportunities are there. And of course, in choosing a partnership, of course, you tend to think of your traditional partners like Europe and the United States because of your historical relationship, as well as their competence in science and technology, both in Europe and in the US. But I would like to ask you to look at other possibilities, like Asia, because many of the knowledge and experiences acquired in Asian countries, Japan is a little bit early example of development, but Korea, Taiwan, you know, in Southeast Asia, China, and all these countries have ample opportunities to share, ample experiences to share with you, and maybe Latin America too. So I think this movement driven by the SDG Center for Africa is, how we enlarge and expand the partnership across the world. And if that is the motive of SDG Center for Africa, my organization will be very happy to contribute our humble contribution. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Price?
A short comment and a question, really. The comment is that I think it was raised earlier, and I would have put it in my input, that there's some low-hanging fruit with respect to access to electronic databases. And it is iniquitous that in relatively poor countries, we have to pay for something which actually the marginal cost of which is almost zero.
Africa is embarking in this journey of regional integration and all that. It doesn't make sense for each and every one of our universities to specialize in everything else. Let us have, for instance, as an example, Rwanda take lead on issues of ICT, technology, and all that. Other places, trade, medicine, and build economies of scale that will benefit regions and the entire continent. And finally, I think we can benefit a lot from tapping into the huge resources that are available in our diaspora. integrating with them, linking with them, and you can innovate here. They can give us part of their leave, take 1 or 2 months sabbatical and all that, spend them in the continent. I think this way we can begin to go into the right direction of building our tertiary education and go back to the glory days of Makriri, Abadan, and others. It's doable and we can do it. We've done it before. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Chair. Swaniker.
My closing remarks really just a thought, a reflection. I believe that it's getting faster and faster to develop countries. If you go back and you think about how long it took Europe to develop, it probably would take about 1,000 years from when they had the levels of poverty that we see in Africa until they reached high income status. The USA started that journey, took them about 300 years. When Japan started that journey, took them 100 years. Singapore and Korea did it in 60 years. And China has done it in 30 years. Dubai maybe in 15 years. I think at the heart of all this has been two things: education and good leadership. And I believe that we have a unique opportunity, and I'm seeing that here in Rwanda when I just think about what has happened in the last 20 years, to rapidly develop our societies. And there are many things that we have a disadvantage in Africa. There's a lot of poverty, there's a lot of infrastructure challenges and everything, but the one thing we have is a clean slate. And if we think differently, we have the opportunity to actually take leadership as a continent and create the universities of the future, not just for Africa, but for the world. And if we do this, then it won't take us 100 years to see the levels of prosperity that we need to see on the continent, but it requires different thinking.
Thank you very much. And thank you to all my panelists. It's been an absolute pleasure exploring the question of quality of tertiary education in this SDG era and the Agenda 2063, and trying to find the context in which, as Africa, we find ourselves. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to pass a special thanks to my panelists. I would also like to pass a special thanks to our guest of honor, His Excellency the President Paul Kagame, for being part of this conversation.